The Ulster Workers Council General Strike by Maurice, Brinton. The general strike, which completely paralyzed Northern Ireland from the 14th to the 28th of May, was one of the most complete and total strikes the British Isles has ever seen. What happened showed the power of a mass workers' movement to bring the authorities to their knees. The inability of the government to deal with the threat only emphasizes the increasing vulnerability of the system to such challenges. As technology and complexity of production develop, military intervention appears ham-handed and becomes increasingly ineffective. In spite of all its limitations and the reactionary character of some of its components, the struggle in Ulster also emphasized the creative potential of the working class, its ability to ensure the distribution of essential food, the organization of mass pickets, the ability to control the movement, and the allocation of fuel and other supplies to essential users. Significantly enough, joint supply arrangements for both Protestant and Catholic areas began to emerge. There can be little doubt that the strike, after a patchy start, gained widespread support from the Protestant working class. Intimidation there was, most notoriously, at Larne, where the Ulster Defence Association, UDA, left no one with much choice in the matter. But as Brendan Clifford of the Workers Association pointed out, quote, "Wouldn't it be remarkable if some groups of white-collar workers were defying a campaign of intimidation that was paralyzing tens of thousands of hardened engineering workers?" End quote. Support for the strike came from housewives, old age pensioners, whole working class families, in fact, from the whole spectrum of the Protestant working class. The quote, "return to work," end quote, on the 26th of May, organized by local trade union officials, some of them Communist Party members, and led by Len Murray, General Secretary of the TUC, was a complete flop, but perhaps it gave a useful foretaste of the role of the TUC in the events of a major class confrontation in Britain. A similar mobilization for different political objectives, or even for similar objectives but by different participants, would probably have received the enthusiastic support of the traditional left, with marches, demonstrations, resolutions, and petitions. But in this case, we got the Social Democratic and Labour Party, SDLP, and some other, quote, lefties, end quote, calling on the Labour government to act sternly and use troops on a wide scale against the strikers. On the 27th of May, at the behest of the, quote, socialist, end quote, SDLP, troops were moved into 17 petrol stations, quote, to ensure petrol supplies, end quote. The response was a complete ban by the Ulster Workers' Council on all work on electricity generation, gas, water supplies, and sewage disposal. The next day, the Northern Ireland executive collapsed. The strike had been, quote, successful, end quote. Now that workers in the north have discovered their own power, they will also discover their conditions remain completely unchanged, quote, victory, end quote, notwithstanding. We hope that they will begin to act increasingly in their own interest rather than for, quote, loyalism, end quote. The general strike in Ulster will provide us with no blueprints for taking power or redirecting society towards socialist objectives. The general strike got nowhere near the point of running society, which would include actually producing the necessities of life. It only scratched the surface of distributing available supplies according to the immediate needs of the working class community. How different would be the situation in Ireland today if there had been a socialist movement committed to working class unity rather than the slavish and uncritical support given to Catholic nationalism by the traditional left, which over the years has actually contributed to worsening sectarian divisions? There is clear evidence that the working class in the north of Ireland, whether Catholic or Protestant, is beginning to act as a force independent of either the Irish or British ruling classes. It is beginning to show its hostility to the nationalist politicians from whom for so long they have been content to follow. Even Glenn Barr, a leader of the UWC, showed some awareness of this when he gave an interview to the Irish radio on the 23rd of June. He said, quote, "The Protestant community have shown their willingness to cast off the old-style politicians who wave the Union Jack every 5 years. We hope that the Roman Catholic community would now do the same and reject the tricolor-waving politicians from their side so that we can get down to proper clean politics, class politics," end quote. The final outcome of the struggle is still anyone's guess, but the importance of the strike cannot be ignored by any of the analysts, soothsayers, manipulators, and would-be political leaders of right or left. All those who have for so long been shouting, quote, victory to the IRA, end quote, now find themselves in a difficult position. Their mindless generalizations about British imperialism in Ulster and support for Irish Catholic nationalism have placed them where they belong, among all the other self-appointed leaderships, miles away from where the new movement is emerging, miles away from anywhere workers struggle for their own interests, refusing to heed the, quote, saviors from on high, end quote. The positive aspects of the strike should not be exaggerated. The authoritarian and paramilitary UDA with its strong right-wing connections was still a dominant force. The Craigs, West, and Paisleys were reluctantly allowed to climb aboard the wagon, but the experience of active involvement in organizing the practicalities of daily life and the demonstration of working-class strength and solidarity, however limited, may not be so easily erased from people's memories. This does not mean that we should, quote, support the UWC or blind ourselves to its character. We should not kid ourselves that sectarianism is still not a dominating factor in the working class on both sides of the religious divide. But it is also too easy and is far more common to overstress the reactionary character of the May mobilization. Certainly some reactionary features emerge, but as usual, reality is rather more complicated than slogans. For us, worker self-management is the necessary institutional form for a free society, but it must have a socialist content. It is therefore important to make a clear distinction between self-activity, even on a mass scale, and socialist self-management, i.e. self-management geared to the objective of creating a non-alienated, non-exploitative, non-authoritarian society in which wage labor has been established. In which wage labor has been abolished. Solidarity, Volume 7, Issue 11.